Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about hypernatremia, not hyponatremia, but hypernatremia. And this is defined as any sodium concentration that is greater than 145. Now, just as a reminder, anything that ends in the word or the letters emia refers to something that is in the blood. So we're talking about an elevated sodium concentration that is in the blood. Now, if you want to know about hyponatremia, please refer to our hyponatremia lectures. Now, if you may recall, when someone has hyponatremia, the first thing that you need to do is you need to figure out whether it is hypertonic, isotonic, or hypotonic. And then you need to figure out if it's hypovolemic, hypervolemic, or isovolemic. With hypernatremia, however, almost all of these issues with hypernatremia are also hypertonic, which means that the tonicity of the serum is high. So the next thing you need to figure out when you have someone that has a high sodium concentration on their blood test is to figure out what it's due to. Is you've just got to figure out what the volume is of the patient. What is the volume? And that simply is the volume too high or hypervolemic? Is it too low from hypovolemia, or is it the same, what we call isovolemia? The first thing we'll talk about is actually going to be hypovolemic hypernatremia. Then we'll talk about hypervolemic hypernatremia. And then we'll talk about isovolemic hypernatremia. So I'm going to divide the screen into three areas. The first one is going to be hypovolemic hypernatremia. So we can talk about that one. The next one we'll talk about after that is hypervolemic hypernatremia. And let's pick a nice blue color here. Then we'll talk about isovolemic hypernatremia. Okay, so basically we've got people who have high sodiums who look like they don't have a lot of fluid. We have people with high sodiums that look like they have a lot of fluid, and we have people with high sodiums that look like their volume status is about the same. By far, the most common is the hypovolemic hypernatremia. These, by definition, are people who have lost salt and water, but they've actually lost more water than they have salt. And as a result of that, their sodium concentration in their body goes up. So the key here is they've lost lots of water and sodium, but they've lost more water than sodium. And the way I want to kind of show that is through a graph. Now, this is kind of the graph, a similar graph that we used in our hyponatremia talk, and I'm going to kind of use the similar status. Now, this is a graph here, which graphs sodium concentration on the y-axis and volume on the x-axis. This area is the intracellular fluid, and this is the extracellular fluid. So what first happens here is that the patient is losing water and sodium both. And as a result of that, when they're losing water and salt both, all you're going to have is a reduction in volume. Okay? But because the patient is losing more water than salt, their sodium concentration is going to go up. Now, when the sodium concentration goes up on the extracellular side, what's going to happen is water is going to go from the intracellular side to the extracellular side to to offset that high sodium concentration. And as a result, the sodium concentration in the intracellular fluid will also go up, and it will lose some of its volume. And so this is what you will have. Yellow meaning the pathological process, white being the normal. Okay, so again, you lose volume and water, and as a result of that, sodium concentration goes up. And of course, the sodium concentration in the intracellular side and the extracellular side should always be the same, because water can freely go through that permeable membrane. And as a result, you lose intracellular volume as well. Now, there's two reasons why this could happen. Okay? There is the non-renal reason. Non-renal. And of course, there is the renal. Now, what would be the non-renal reason why someone would lose this? Well, if they were having sweating or diarrhea, or probably the most common reason that I see is they're elderly, they're in a nursing home, and they have these insensible losses, but they can't get up to get a drink of water. And so I see these patients coming in from the nursing home with high sodiums, and they look very dry, and they fit into this category. And the most likely reason is because they're just becoming dehydrated. So how do I know? What's the hallmark of that? Well, you know that if the kidney is not getting enough blood flow, it's going to want to hold on to as much sodium as possible. And so therefore, the telltale sign that this is a non-renal hypovolemic hypernatremia is that the sodium concentration is going to be less than 10 in the urine. Okay? Now, what about renal? What are some renal causes for a hypovolemic hypernatremia? Well, you could have an osmotic diuresis. And what would be the reason for that? Well, if you have a bleed in the brain patient and they're on mannitol. Okay, so we give them mannitol, that's going to cause a diuresis, getting rid of free water through this osmotic diuresis through the kidney, and that's going to cause the sodium concentration to go up. What's the telltale sign? Well, obviously, if you know the patient's on mannitol, that'll explain it. But here, the urine concentration of sodium is going to be greater than 20. So what's the treatment for this? The treatment for a hypovolemic hypernatremia is, what do you think? If you're losing salt and water, the treatment is going to be normal saline. So we have these patients coming in from the nursing home that are dehydrated and their sodium is high. We don't want to just give them water. We want to give them salt and water. And this is kind of paradoxical, because you're saying to yourself, well, this patient's sodium is elevated. Well, that's true. Their sodium is elevated, but they're also volume deficient. And so in these cases, even though their sodium's maybe in the 150s, I give normal saline because I know that they are behind in volume. And it's only once you correct that volume, if their sodium is still high, then I will go ahead and give them free water. But I will never give them free water first, because what happens when I give free water? Free water will only correct the concentration of sodium that's elevated. It will not correct this volume, because remember, free water gets distributed throughout the entire system. And this is what I want to correct first, is the volume deficit. And that's why I give normal saline. Okay, let's talk about hypervolemic hypernatremia. It's kind of rare, don't see it much. Wouldn't jump to the conclusion that that's what it is when I see it in a patient. But what's going on here is you're getting lots of sodium retention. In fact, you're retaining salt plus water, but guess what you're retaining more of? You're retaining more sodium than you are water. And a lot of things can happen here. You could get, what are some reasons why you could do this? Over-resuscitation with IV fluids. Okay, so IV fluids could do it. Or in a code situation, if you're giving a lot of sodium bicarbonate in a code situation, I've seen that before. So that's predominantly how that happens. Now, in terms of why this could be caused, this would be a what we call a non-renal reason or a excess of fluids. But what else could happen? Well, before we get to that, let's actually draw a picture and show what's going on. So let's draw our normal situation. Here's our intracellular fluid. Here's our extracellular fluid. Here's our intracellular fluid. So we said here that we had retention of sodium and water, but more sodium than water. So what's the first thing that's going to happen? The first thing that is going to happen is we're going to have sodium and water giving us a larger volume. But because we're also retaining more salt than water, our extracellular fluid compartment is going to go up in concentration. Now, as a result of that higher concentration, intracellular fluid is going to shift into the extracellular fluid. Water is going to go through that semipermeable membrane. And as a result of that water leaving, the sodium concentration is going to go up in that intracellular fluid compartment, and it will have less volume. So this is the shift that we will see. Now, what's another reason in addition to IV fluids and sodium bicarbonate? Well, there's another thing that could cause it, and that is mineral corticoid excess. We see this in things like Cushing syndrome. Remember in our adrenal cortex, in the zona glomerulosa, there is a hormone called aldosterone. Aldosterone causes sodium reabsorption and potassium excretion in the distal convoluted tubule. This excessive mineral corticoid secretion could cause elevated sodium levels in exactly this sort of a state. So what's the treatment? Well, if we're retaining too much sodium and water in this situation, then diuretics should work, especially those that cause salt wasting. And of course, giving free water will not hurt either. Okay, let's talk about isovolemic. So here, we're not losing volume. That's the key there, is isovolemic means no loss in volume. But what we are seeing here is loss of free water. Just simple free water is being lost. So what would be the non-renal reasons why this would be? Well, if we're losing free water, it could be simply that we're no longer retaining that free water. The other possibility is that if we're losing that free water, it's because we no longer have the antidiuretic hormone, which, as you recall, works on the collecting tubule to reabsorb free water from the collecting tubule. Remember, the nephron looks like this, loop of Henle, and then you have the collecting tubule. Remember that the ADH works here to reabsorb free water. If for some reason the brain is not secreting ADH, this would be the opposite of the syndrome of inappropriate ADH. This would be like what we call a diabetes insipidus. The other possibility is you could get nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Nephrogenic diabetes insipidus is where the kidney is not responding to the antidiuretic hormone. Okay? So there's a number of reasons why. Either you're not secreting enough antidiuretic hormone from the posterior pituitary or not making it in the hypothalamus, or the collecting tubule is simply not responding to it and you get a nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. The treatment in all of these situations is simply free water replacement. Just free water. So how is that going to look in terms of our diagram? Again, here is our extracellular fluid compartment. Extracellular fluid and then intracellular fluid. Okay, so again, here we are simply losing free water. And so what is that going to look like? Well, we're not actually changing volume here. The volume is the same. So all we see is, since free water is being lost, the concentration of the extracellular fluid is going to go up. Now, as a result of the extracellular fluid going up, what's going to happen? water is going to go from the intracellular fluid over to the extracellular fluid. And as a result of that, you're going to lose intracellular fluid compartment space. And in a lot of cases here, this volume line doesn't really move much from where it started. You notice how it doesn't move much? It might move a little bit, but it's not going to move very much. And that is the reason why it's called isovolemic. Again, the treatment is free water. So I would recommend that if this doesn't make a lot of sense to you, go ahead and review our hyponatremia lecture. Also review our adrenal gland lecture and make sure that you understand what it is that's going on there. Thanks for joining us.